That's outside of Baku. These fires have been burning for thousands of years.
4,200 years ago, certain yogis from India went to Greece. This is a Manipuraka chakra.
Is an extraordinary presence of Vishuddhi. Just hits you in the throat.
Life from somewhere has chosen this almost like an airport.
They are trying to build a future human being.
Azerbaijan means land of fire. So there are places where naturally natural gas is coming out, seeping out of the land, and it's on fire. So for thousands of years, these fires have been burning, and this Hindu temple, which was built around this burning fire of natural gas, is estimated to be over 8,500 years old. It's been many times rebuilt, but the original one is supposed to be about 8,500 years old. Here we are at the fire temple in Azerbaijan, just outside of Baku. These fires have been burning for thousands of years. This is a sacred space. And for the ancient Hindus of this land, and also from Hindus from Afghanistan, Pakistan, and the present-day India, which was all generally known as Hindustan at one time, all of them came here. This is like another Kashi in Central Asia, where people came here. One reason is to live, another reason is to die, because this is a culture which identified that living well is very important, but dying well is equally important. So for that reason, they always came to a sacred place to die, as still millions of people go to Kashi to die. This was one of the places that culture has diminished, but still a lot of thousands of pilgrims come here visiting this fire temple.
Little over 4,200 years ago, certain yogis from India went to Greece and established certain lingas, consecrated certain lingas, which are known as the navel of the earth. I saw this picture almost like 15 years ago somewhere, and immediately I recognized this is a Manipuraka chakra. And who created this? Where is it? Then they said, this is in Delphi. I've been wanting to go there, and took 15 years to get there, because we went to these few places where the lingas were, and it's more than 4,200, 4,300, still alive. They've replaced them. They took them from the original sites and kept it in the museums. But still they're alive. You can't kill them. That's the beauty of it.
Something really powerful is had here. Long, long time ago. Still with earth is still rich with it.
Nagendra Haraya Trilochanaya Vasmangarakaya Maheshwaraya Nityaya Shuddhaya Digambaraya Vasmai Nakaraya Namah Shivaya.
There are three chakras.
Yes.
One is the navel. The other two are the supporting chakras of Muladhara and Swadhishthana. This is a fantastic way of doing it. That's how we have done the Bhairavi, but in a single form. Here they built like a temple. There are places like this in South India, not this grand, but similar system of temples where you build chakras. If you have to do a composite form of all three or all seven, it's a much bigger challenge. But to establish separately like this is so much easier.
Thank you.
Here we are, the Grand Canyon. Formed over millions of years, exposing geological history of this place, which goes back to 1.8 billion years as they estimate. It's essentially Colorado River cutting down nearly a mile into the earth. But here is a living proof of what kind of earth moving happens over a million years or so. It's absolutely incredible, unimaginable. Grand Canyon, as grand as it can be. Initially, I thought it's the rocks, but it's the very space. And it's so sensitive to human presence and able to recognize certain things about what we're doing. It's quite incredible. Just natural forces. I'm sure those natives who are sensitive to this dimension would definitely say there are spirits working upon them, which they're not very wrong in a way. It's the spirit of the earth. They're not very wrong, but not in the sense of some ghosts functioning. But there's a phenomenal amount of energy flow, and well, there are many places, natural features which have a certain amount of energy. But the important thing is the way it's responding to human presence. Unbelievable. As we range through the plains of Wyoming, one thing that stood out in my experience is Matotipila. Matotipila is an extraordinary presence of Vishuddhi. Not just unusual, it's just incredible that such a thing has manifested. I don't know how, but it is a powerful sense of Vishuddhi. I've never seen anything like that except Kailash. Well, Dhyanalinga is there, but that's of a different nature, it's too subtle. I've never seen a natural formation which exudes that kind of Vishuddhi. Matotipila just hits you in the throat. It's one die, unidimensional. So because this is Vishuddhi, it is incredible that the rocks have taken on six-faced form, largely, most of them. And there it stands magnificently today, almost like Shiva's throat. It's a headless Shiva, that's what it's looking like. So, this dimension of life is very, very rare. There are various centers in the world which activates different dimensions, but the throat center being this powerful is hardly 2-3 places in the entire globe, I'm telling you. I was just amazed. The way it is reverberating with this dimension of life is just absolutely amazing. I do not know how it has happened. Nature has done it. In India, we create our own structures. You know, we create consecrated structures to reverberate this kind of energy. But what we make is of small proportions. But here it is standing in such a magnificent form. One need not necessarily be in its physical presence. One can connect with such a powerful dimension anywhere.
There's a tremendous amount of activity in the lake, and this activity is, the nature of the activity is such that it has nothing to do with anything that we know as life on this planet. It's something totally different. It's life, but not the way we know it. I wouldn't call Manasarovar a spiritual place because spirituality is out of human being. These beings, if you can call them that, I don't know what we can call them, whether we can call them beings or things or creatures or what. We have no words for things or happenings which don't belong to our realm of experience. They don't belong to anything that we know as life. So this is not really a spiritual place, but somehow life from somewhere has chosen this almost like an airport. They're just landing, taking off at a tremendous pace. This is just crazy. This doesn't stand to any reason. Why for millions of years, one particular spot on the planet has been used by life which doesn't belong here? Why? And why the same place? And why for so long?
Seeing what's been happening in Manasarovar, one conjecture could be that these forces or these beings could be responsible for the making of the human beings. That's one theory. Another is probably they are trying to build a future human being.
Or this is their workshop where they are trying to build themselves a human body to participate in life that is happening here on this planet.
Why Kailash has always been considered as the abode of many great beings is because many great beings chose to deposit their work, preserve their work in Kailash. Starting from Shiva himself, and the first of the Tirthankars, and two of greatest Buddhist teachers, all these people chose Kailash Parvat as a place to preserve their work. When I say preserving work, for most mystics on this planet, till now, in all these thousands of years, if they get to share 1 or 2% of their work with people around them, they are very fortunate. Most of them don't even get to do that. So they always chose to deposit in some space which is not too frequented by human beings. At the same time, it's accessible for those who wish to go. So Kailash is such a place. It is not totally inaccessible, but it's hard enough to discourage a lot of people. There are many, many places like that. But in terms of the volume and the variety that's been deposited in Kailash, it is the place.